Welcome. Are you stirred up and ready to go? Yes, okay. That's good. Good morning. So good to have you here with us and to have those of you join us online as well. Welcome. If you're new with us today, welcome. And there's a little blue card you'll find right beside you. We'd love you to fill that in. Drop that by the office on your way out if you're today so we can connect with you this week. Or if you're online, you can connect with us at Calvary or guest at calvary.on.ca. And we'll get back in touch with you as well. Just a reminder that February 27th coming up is our annual general celebration. We're looking so forward to that. Set that on your calendars. It'll be 6 o'clock and lots of praise items and election of deacons and those kinds of things. So that's the annual general celebration, February 27th. So take note of that. The psalmist, David, in Psalm 35... established a psalm that many songwriters have gone on to use in terms of praising God. And it goes this way: "The Lord be exalted, who delights in the well-being of his servant. My tongue will speak of your righteousness and of your praises all day long." Beloved, let's lift up our voices and praise him, shall we?
Amen. Let's do that this morning. Would you stand with us? And let's lift a shout of praise to our great God today. Let's sing.
I saw my guilt upon your cross. I found new life from what was lost. I am free. How can it be? You broke the power of canceled sin. You brought this child back home again. I am free, how can it be? Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing my great Redeemer's praise. The glories of my God and King, the triumphs of your grace. Darkness with your love, you washed me white in crimson flood, and I am free. How can it be? Oh, I am free. How can it be? Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing my great Redeemer's praise. The glories of my God of your grace. You triumphed over my every mistake, over the depths of my shame, over the prison of fear. You have the victory here.
Come on, church!
Over the sting of the grave.
Can see no one here has been blessed with a thousand tongues, but you all, it looks like, have been blessed with one. That one tongue needs to be used to glorify, to praise, to bring worth to our great God. He is worthy of all of our praise. Amen, church. So let's continue using that tongue for what it was made to do. It was made to praise the Lord. Let's do that today. Sing it out.
Your love is devoted like a ring of solid gold, like a vow that is tested, like a covenant of old. Your love is enduring through the winter rain, beyond the horizon, with mercy for today. Faithful you have been, and faithful you will be. You pledge yourself to me, and that's why
church, it is important, it is critical that we use our tongues to praise our great God. Amen? Amen. You can have a seat.
Let us pray together this morning, church. Father, it is your kindness that makes us whole. You shoulder our weakness, and your strength becomes our own. Lord, we love you so very much, and we come together today as the church, and we use our tongues this morning to praise you, to seek you, to worship you. And now we pray to you, help us in our need. Father, as we gather in your presence today, would you comfort the lonely? Would you help the hurting? Would you heal the sick? By name this morning, we pray for June and Len and Aki and Ray and our little Henry and Gabrielle. Father, we pray that you would draw close to this group of people that we are naming before your throne. For Evelyn and Bud and Edward and Lorraine and Angela and Samantha. Father, you know their needs. We've been praying for these people for a few weeks. And God, we pray that you would help them in the cause of Christ, that you would help them to grow close to you, to draw close to you. And they're feeling overwhelmed today, God. And I know that you know every need in this room today. Those who are participating online, God, we just pray that you would help those who are calling out to you. We know that you bend your ear down. God, for those who are shut in this morning, represented by Muriel Hooper, God, we may be shut in, but we are not shut out from you. And I just pray for her this morning, and I pray for those of the church who cannot make it out in person. We pray that you would help them. We love that we are able to partner with people both locally and globally who have the cause of Christ as their mission, and for our global partners this morning, for Michael and Diane Fiji with More Network Outreach Canada, we pray for them. Lord, we ask that you would bless them this week. I pray that you would give them divine appointments so that they can share the gospel and equip the leaders that they are working with. We pray for our mission agency this morning, Flying Bow, God. We just pray that you would be with Trevor Dick and his ministry there as they reach out and use the gift of music to bless people. Father, this morning as we open up your word, we pray that you would open up our hearts and that you would be with our pastor as he teaches us about your love. Thank you for the great care of our intense lives. God, our lives can be messy sometimes, and you don't run away from that. You actually draw closer to us. You don't leave us or forsake us, even when we feel, when our emotions are overwhelming us, God. You're there. You're with us. You're turning to us. We trust you, and we know that there is a deep, deep love from you, our Father, a love so deep that you sent Jesus to save and redeem your church. So this morning, as your church, we turn to you and we say thank you for redeeming us. We love you. We look forward to what you're going to do this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, would you stand with us again, and let's continue to praise our God. Thank him for his amazing love. How deep, how high, how wide, how long is the love of Christ? Let's sing to him now.
Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he would give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of seeming loss among the scoffers.
Church, aren't you thankful for the amazing love of our God that sent his son to die on our behalf? That is love. Amen. You can have a seat.
Let's pray together. Our Lord and our God, the one who loves us and has demonstrated that love for us, in this, that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And so, our Father, this morning, as we focus our thoughts on the God who is love, who has demonstrated to us in a most extreme way what love is. As we focus our attention, Lord, I pray this morning that you will enable our hearts to receive and to welcome the truth. I pray, Father, for those who are gathered here or in the hearing of this, whose hearts are hurting and broken, because their lives are in situations where love seems very scarce. I pray, Father, that the reality of your love will encourage and strengthen and release and rescue people from the wilderness of feeling unloved to the promise of God's love. I pray this in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. perhaps the most misrepresented of all the doctrines of God is the love of God. I think it's the doctrine most abused in our world. Our world pictures a subjective God whose love endorses anything and everything that makes them happy, because that's the loving thing to do. And people will say, the God I believe in, who's a loving God, wants everyone to find joy in whomever and however, in loving whomever and however. And he also doesn't want unwanted children to live if that would make me happy. Donald Carson, in his very helpful book entitled The Difficult Doctrine of the Love of God, writes this: I do not think that what the Bible says about the love of God can long survive at the forefront of our thinking if it is abstracted from the sovereignty of God, the holiness of God, the wrath of God, the providence of God, or the personhood of God, to mention only a few non-negotiable elements of basic Christianity. The result, of course, is that the love of God in our culture has been purged of anything the culture finds uncomfortable. I'm not so sure it's only the culture that purges the doctrine of the love of God from anything that's uncomfortable. I think we as well, God's people, have some pretty skewed ideas of what the love of God really is. So what does the promise of God's love mean to believers? Because today we want to look at what it means to move from the wilderness of feeling unloved, and I also put in brackets being unloved. Being unloved, by the way, by people, not by God, into the promise of being loved by God. What we know is often shouted down by how we feel. Do you agree? Particularly in this area of God's love. And many who struggle with the love of God has also struggled because of a background, a family background that has struggled with the concept of love. My prayer and goal for this time together is really found in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 18 and 19. I'll read it to you. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the saints to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Now notice, now to him who is able to do immeasurably more, put it in the context here, than all we ask or imagine according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. That's my prayer for you this morning. Paul's prayer for all believers, my prayer for you, Paul's prayer for the Ephesians and other believers, and my prayer for you is that today you may grasp the greatness of the love of God. I want to make a statement to you that I hope is helpful. The saving love of God necessitates the sanctifying love of God. And this is where we get into challenges with our feelings and the love of God. The saving love of God necessitates the sanctifying love of God, or the transforming or changing love of God. What it takes from God's love to change us, which isn't always comfortable. So the love that saves us also shapes us, which is sometimes very emotionally confusing. Now, I want to give you a quick overview, a quick chart of truth that you can look at this morning and get a picture, hopefully, of some of the reality of our feelings versus truth. We all agree that God is good, yes? And we agree that his purposes are good, yes? But the situation we are required to bear within that reality may not be good, yes? a little less commitment. Now, I want to match it to another reality of truth. God is love, yes? All of his purposes toward his beloved are loving, yes? Say it with enthusiasm, yes. The situation we are required to bear may not feel like one loved should be in, yes? Now, here's the problem. We regularly start from the bottom of these lists. We start with, we're looking at our situation, we're thinking about our situation, and we start to draw conclusions about truth from the bottom up instead of the top down. Critical, I mean, if anything can help you, this should help you. God is good, and God is love. No matter what situation you are in, that does not change. That God is love and that God is good never changes regardless of the situation you're in. Now that's a starting point for us because we war with our feelings. We look to the bottom of that list and build our thinking from there. Don't do that. Start from the top of the list and build your thinking in every situation. I know God is love. And I know God is good. Now, so how I feel must give way to what is true. Because it is the truth that sets us free. Sets us free from our feelings. In order that we can embrace what is true and benefit from it. Because if we languish around in our feelings, particularly in this great doctrine of the love of God, we run the potential of missing out on the benefits of God's love in the most needed times. Okay. So, God is committed, by the way, to his long-term, eternal purposes for us. And that may very well be interrupted by short-term discomfort. Okay, so the Bible in 1 John chapter 4, verses 9 and 10 makes it abundantly clear to us that this is how God has showed love among us. This is how God has showed love among us. If I were to ask you, how has God showed you love? This is your answer. This is how God has showed love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world so that we might live through him. This is how God has showed love to us. I'm going to come back to this at the very end as we transition to communion. But let's set it up that way. So I want to look very quickly with you this morning at three amazing truths concerning you and God's love. Turn in your Bibles, first of all, to Ephesians chapter 1, please. Ephesians chapter 1. I want to read a most outstanding text to you this morning. Ephesians chapter 1, we're just going to look at verses 4 and 6, 4 to 6. 4, he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us to be adopted as his sons through Jesus Christ in accordance with his pleasure and will to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given us in the one he loves. There's some heavy doctrine stuff here, but let me unpack it for you. The first of these amazing truths that we can grab right out of this text is this. You and I are providentially loved. We are loved providentially. Now remember what we understood providential to be last week? We understood it to be God's directive, protective care of us. You are loved providentially. You may have lived with lifelong insecurities about your own value or your own significance in this life and in this world. But this should help you very much with respect to that. Because unlike so many who have struggled with this sense of needing, seeking to gain approval from people, needing to feel loved and all of that, the truth of the matter is, for the believer, is this: we don't earn the Heavenly Father's love. He chooses to grant it to us. He chooses to give it to us. He chooses to set His affection upon us. That's an amazing thing. And it's not because of anything we've done. It's not because we're lovely or lovable. It's because He chooses. When were you and I first loved? Now, I'm speaking to believers now. When were you and I first loved? Well, according to this and according to other places in Scripture, we were first loved as we were included in Christ's crucifixion prize. The song we just sang, one of the lyrics says, "Why should I gain from His reward?" His reward is us. The Heavenly Father awarded Christ us. You say, what are you talking about? Well, look at here. When Jesus was questioned about the relationship of He and the Father, and John records it in John chapter 6, verse 37, Jesus said this: "All that the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me, I will never drive away." And John records again several chapters later in John 10, verse 29, Jesus saying, "My Father who has given them to me is greater than all." Paul writes to the Ephesians and explains how we were given to Jesus. It says in verse 4, or verse 5, just before verse 5, "In love, He predestined us to be adopted as sons through Jesus Christ." In verse 4, "For He chose us in Him." In love, God predestined us to be adopted as His sons through Christ Jesus. Because of His love, because of God's love, there will always be a people of God. That's what Paul's writing here. But only because of Jesus. We were placed in Christ. That's why he stresses in these three verses, He chose us in Him. We were adopted through Jesus Christ. To the praise of His glorious grace, which He has freely given us in the one, meaning Jesus, He loves. And when did all of this happen? He tells us in the text, before the foundation of the world. For He chose us in Him before the creation of the world. Before the foundation of the world, the message here is there existed a God who chose to have an eternal relationships with people. For no other reason, Paul says, than because of His love. In love, He predestined us to be the reward of Christ's crucifixion, placing us in Christ before we were even born. That's why Paul can write to the Romans and say that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. You and I weren't there at Calvary, but we were there at Calvary because of the truth that God placed us in Christ before we even existed. Is this too much for your mind space? I mean, this is mind-boggling. I realize that, but that's what this truth is all about. I mean, for any of us who are believers to feel the least bit insecure about our lives, this is meant to chase that away, to dispel that away. If any of us are wondering about the value of our lives, the purpose of our lives, who we are to God, what God thinks of us, what value we are to God, this is to chase that away. In that love, we, by the way, bear responsibility of living a holy and blameless life. Do you see that? For he chose us in Jesus before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight, to live for him. So, by virtue of being gifted to Christ, who is the chosen one, who is literally the elect one, this is all about Jesus that Paul's talking about and our inclusion in Jesus. He's the elect one. Just as Israel was the elect of God, so is Christ the elect of God. Christ is the chosen one of God. And we were added in Christ into this great family of God. So we are in not because of us, but because of Jesus. Do you see this? This is about Christ. People say, well, what about me? What about someone online? Well, how can I be in this? How can I be in on this? Follow Christ. Believe in the Lord, and you will be saved. So, we are purposed, our transformation. This is critical to understand the nature of God's love for us, which is absolutely amazing that he chose us in love, but to be holy and blameless, which means there's some work to do. The love of God not only brings us into salvation, but it also requires our sanctification, our growth. There's work to be done. The shaping of us to be holy and blameless is also immensely a part of the love of God. That's why the chart that I'm saying, God is love, yes, but sometimes the situation we're in feels like we aren't being loved. But in truth, it's part of the blameless holiness shaping, fitting us for glory, life that God is doing in our work in our lives. So you are loved providentially. Secondly, turn in your Bibles to 1 John chapter 4. John of the disciples writes the most about love and the love of God. In 1 John chapter 4, verse 7 to 18, I want to read the text. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. And then in verse 10, he defines love. This is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is made complete in us. We know that we live in him and he in us because he has given us his Spirit. And we have seen and testify that the Father has sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. If anyone acknowledges that Jesus is the Son of God, God lives in him and he in God. And so we know and rely on the love God has for us. Underline that verse. So we know and rely on the love God has for us. God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God and God in him. In this way, love is made complete among us so that we will have confidence on the day of judgment, because in this world we are like him. There is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear, because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. I'm going to stop there. There's so much more we could talk, but I want to focus our thoughts right here. You are loved not only providentially, but you are loved perfectly. You are loved perfectly. I mean, the question comes up, what is love supposed to look like? What is love supposed to be like? And God answers the question through John's writing here. This is love. Not that we loved him, but that he initiated a love for us. That he gave love. He gave his love. He loved us, but that he loved us and sent his son as a, says in the text, atoning sacrifice. The word is a propitiation for our sins. In other words, that word means that Christ, because of the love of God, turned away the wrath of God that was upon us because of our sins. Atoning sacrifice really doesn't tell anybody much of anything, but propitiation certainly does. That word means averting the wrath of God, turning away the wrath of God. This is an important position to be in, to have the wrath of God diverted from us. And we are loved perfectly by God because God is love. So God's expression of love toward us is perfect since he's the source of love. We have the people floating around our culture saying love is love. That's the most absurd statement I've ever heard in my entire life. God is love. God is love because God is the source of love. God is the inventor of love, if you will. He's the only one that can define love for this world. And if we are loved by the very source of love, it ensures to us that there can be no better love showered upon us. Let me think about it. If the author and inventor of love loves you, there's no better love out there to be showered upon you than the love of the inventor and source of love. That's what this text is telling us. That's what's assuring us. The world simply says love is love to cut God out of the equation so they can define subjectively what they think love is. It really should be translated as lust is lust, because that's the only reason people use that phrase. Because God is love. And that makes it possible, because of his love, makes it possible for people to actually live. That's what he says in this text. And that's why in verse 12, it says, no one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is, the word is complete here, but it means perfected in us. Complete's an okay translation, because perfected means to be made complete. It means to be brought to its intended purpose. The love of God that he has granted to us is intended to be made perfect in us. The perfect love given to us is to be made perfect in us. How does that happen? Verse 16 tells us, by relying on the love of God, the love that he has for us. Your love, the love that God gives to you, is made complete, is made mature, is brought to its intended completion as you rely upon the love God has for you by loving one another. Do you see this? That's why in verse 7, verse 11, verse 12, so we don't miss it, John's writing it so many times so you can't miss it. How is love going to be perfected in me? How am I going to grow in love? How am I going to experience the full benefits of God's love for me? John says it three times, John 7, John verse 11, 12, loving one another. We are loved by God perfectly in order to love one another so that love, the love of God in us, might be brought to its intended completion. its intended perfection in us. God is turning us into people who love like Him. This is the amazing and immense reality of salvation. Regeneration heals us so thoroughly inside that it enables us to express love fully to one another on the outside. Now, I know that many of you are saying, wait a second, I'm not there yet. I understand this. I don't think any of us are necessarily there yet. The point is, this is an active work of God in our lives, perfecting love in us. And the more you rely on the love of God by loving fellow believers, the more perfect the love of God is being made in you. This is not a mystery. This is not rocket science. You want to experience the perfecting love of God? Love your brother and sister. There's another immensely important section to this that I just don't want to leave, because so many of us miss the fullness of this perfecting love. Not only is our love perfected in our love for one another, but the perfecting love of God in our lives drives fear out of our life. Do you see the section that John gives to verse 18? There is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear, because fear has to do with punishment. If I were to ask most of you, if I were to say to you, what motivates your good behavior? What motivates you to keep the rules of God? And I know this to be true, because these surveys have been done multiple times. The vast majority of Christians say, I keep the rules because I don't want to get in trouble with God. And that's the wrong answer. You'll never, ever experience the perfecting love of God in your life if you allow that to be the motivation for why you keep the commands of Christ. Because I don't want to get in trouble with God. That means that you're still living in fear of punishment. And part of the problem is how most of us were raised and all of that. That's, you know, there's punishment attached to disobedience. And I don't want you to get the idea that there aren't consequences to sin, that God doesn't work on areas of discipline and disciplines us in our lives, but He doesn't punish us. Paul, all over the scriptures, there is now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. Love and fear are not meant to cohabit in the Christian life. The Bible's filled with fear not. Fear is supposed to be gone. We're living in fear. Believers are living in fear like other people. We weren't saved to live in fear. And the love of God is intended to chase fear out of our lives. Fear has to do with punishment. Is God going to punish you? He's not going to punish you. He may discipline you for your good. That's not punishment. He will not punish. Perfect love drives out fear. So keeping commands is the evidence that I love God. It's recorded in John 14, 15. Jesus says, if you love me, keep my commandments. So our keeping of the commandments is the evidence, Jesus says, that you love me. That's the evidence that you love me. But the motivation to keep my commands has to be from the realization that you, God, love me. I'm seeking to keep the commands of Christ because I know He loves me. And I love Him. And I want to please Him. I'm not worried about punishment from Him. I want to please Him. So I'm freed by God's love. And the problem is, if we continue to allow the motivation for us to keep the commands of Christ to be on the basis of our fear of punishment of God, we will actually become more rebellious. We become rebels. I don't have time to go into it, but if you read Romans 7, Paul gives the explanation for that. He says that the commandments, he talks about in Romans 7 that keeping commandments out of fear of God resulted in me remaining rebellious and a rebel. The reason so many Christians are rebellious and rebels is because you are trying to keep the commands of Jesus Christ on the basis of fear and not on the basis of the fact that he loves you. If you keep the commandments of Christ on the basis of the realization that God really loves you, you will become less and less rebellious, less and less a rebel. You can chew on that in your DCs tonight. Talk more about that, because we got to move. And by the way, what if I'm not feeling it? What if I'm not feeling the love of God? Listen, ask the Holy Spirit to help you, because the Holy Spirit is responsible for helping you to sense and experience the love of God. But fellowship with God's people. Well, nice people who are God's people. Loving people who are God's people. People who will love you. Not crusty, cranky, annoying Christians, but nice Christians. The Christians who are on the way to perfecting the love of God, those Christians. Because those Christians, loving you will enable you to be experiencing firsthand the love of God, which will enable you to grow and will help you to yourself be motivated to love. Okay, let's wrap it up with Romans 8 really quickly. So you're loved providentially, you are loved perfectly, and Romans 8 tells us that you are loved permanently. Romans 8:35. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us, for I'm convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. You are loved permanently. The question arises, I mean, this is the real feeling text right here. This is the one where the rubber hits the road. I don't feel loved. There's trouble, there's hardships, there's persecution, there's famine. There's nakedness, there's danger, there's sword. I don't feel loved. If I feel separated from the love of God, can anything, Paul says, really drive a wedge between God's love and me? And the answer, of course, is no, nothing can. God, because God, first of all, is not emotionally vulnerable in the way he loves. That's a beautiful reality. Unlike us, we are so driven by our emotions. God is not emotionally vulnerable like us. Trouble shaping, many of you are parents presently or have been parents or whatever. And I know the hardest thing for me was when I was disciplining the kids to actually continue the sentence. I wanted to let them off. You know, because you know when you discipline the kid, you're always like, you're grounded for the next 15 years. And then you go away and you think, oh man, like that was a little bit of a long sentence. Because we were kind of in emotion and we in a rash moment, throw out some sort of discipline and we want to back away from it. God's never emotionally like that. He actually is not vulnerable. God will not fall prey to his feelings to release us from the life-shaping work, the heart-transforming work that he's doing in our lives, no matter what. Even if it's trouble and hardship and persecution and famine and nakedness, he will not, because of his love for us, release us from any of these things that are heart-shaping for our good and his glory. He will not. And God is not fickle or whimsical in the way he loves. nor can he be intimidated or threatened, because his love is completely connected to all of his other attributes. God's love is never disconnected from God's holiness. God's love is never disconnected from his will. God's love is never disconnected from his wrath. God is always connected fully to all of his attributes. So Paul gives this list. Who? There's an army of nasties listed here. Can these things separate us from the love of God? Trouble, the harshest of life's pressures. When you've been abused, or perhaps you've lost someone important to you. That's what trouble is. What about hardships? When you're confined to an oppressive situation, squeezed in, it's a dead end. You can't see anything good in your future. Can God's love be separated then from you? Or persecution, when you're intentionally targeted for harm, for belonging to Christ. Or famine, doing without, or nakedness, completely destitute. Or danger imposed by the adversary against Christians. Wait a second. A God of love lets us go through these things? Paul says yes. 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 Paul's been through them. Paul's writing on the other side of much of this, and some is yet in front of him. Danger imposed by the adversary against Christians. Sword. Life-threatening violence as prophesied in Psalm 44:22. We're like sheep, considered as sheep to be slaughtered. For your sake we face death all day long. Yep, that's us. And then I won't even go into, I don't have time to look at all of the others. A situation or a reality, present or possible. Powers, circumstances, created things. There's a lot of things lining up in your life that would give you the impression that you can be separated from the love of God. It's immensely comforting to know, beloved. The immensely comforting nature of this promise is the promise of being loved doesn't depend upon you and me. God takes that upon himself. I don't have to keep God loving me. He does. And he promises that nothing can get in the way of that either. So what is for our good is our friend or ally. What is bad is conquered. We are more than conquerors through Christ who loved us. And both are dominated by the loving God who can and does use both to marvelously fit us for guaranteed glory. This is kind of the practical answer to the questions that people had in verse 28. And we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him. And people were saying, like what? What about trouble, Paul? Yes. What about hardship, Paul? Yes. What about persecutions, Paul? Yes. What about nakedness, Paul? Yes. What about famine, Paul? Yes. Anything you can name, height, depth, width, length, principalities, angels, demons, all created things. Did he leave anything out? I don't think so. All of them are seeking to wedge into your heart and convince you that God doesn't love you. And Paul says nothing, none of these things can separate you from Christ, from the love of God in Christ Jesus, who called you into his family before you even existed. There are many separations that occur in our lives. God simply will not allow his love to be one of them. Is that a great truth? Beloved, live in this. Live in this. Father, thank you for this truth. And Lord, as we now really take ourselves to the central focus of your ultimate love for us, I pray, O God, that you will settle our hearts, lift them out of the wilderness of our feelings, and bring them into the central reality of truth, that Jesus Christ gave his life for us because he loves us. Pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I'd like to now invite everyone who is loved by God through salvation and loves Jesus Christ with all of your heart, mind, soul, body to join us at this ceremony. I think it's pretty important for us to recognize that there are many troubles in our lives. But the Word of God asserts something, and that is this, that this is how God has showed his love among us. And this communion table is to bring us back to the focus of God's love. That's why Jesus left this ordinance to us to participate in on a regular basis, that our hearts might not drift away from the love of God, that we might be drawn back regularly to fix our eyes and our heart on the fact that the cross, Jesus giving his life for us, bearing our sins on the cross in our place, is the remarkable assurance to us that God loves us. There is no greater love than this. There is no greater example of love. There is no way that we can understand God's love any better than to come right here and focus on the cross and the elements with which represent the cost of our salvation, that Jesus Christ shed his blood, not because he did anything wrong, and while we were yet sinners and didn't love him, because he loved us. This is to bring our feelings in focus with the truth, that we might be able to experience constantly the love of God, that we might be able to share it with others, and in turn, to serve him with all of our hearts. So I'm going to ask at this time Deacon Paul Robinson to return thanks for the emblem, the element of Christ's body that he gave for us.
Lord Jesus, we bow before you in humility, asking you to examine our hearts today. Show us anything that is not pleasing to you. Reveal any unconfessed sin, any rebellion, or unforgiveness that may be hindering our relationship with you. We know we are your beloved children, having received you into our heart and life, and having accepted your death as penalty for our sinfulness. The price you paid covered us for all time, and our desire is to obey and to live for you. As we take the bread representing your body that was broken for us, we remember and celebrate your faithfulness to all who receive you. You took the pain for us during your crucifixion on the cross. You died for us. You arose on the third day and ascended to the right hand of the Father, where you intercede for us and will return again. Thank you that your death gave us life, abundant life now, and eternal life forever. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for your love, your grace, and your mercy. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Be the
that I should gain, and interest in the Savior's blood. Died he for me who caused his pain, for me who him to death pursued. Amazing love, how can it be that thou, my God, should die for me? He left his Father's throne above, so free, so infinite his grace, emptied himself all for but love, for Adam's helpless race. 'Tis mercy all immense and free, that thou, my God, should die for me. Amazing love, the mighty God, the cross set me free. His beauty says for all of time, my hope and victory. No condemnation of his embrace. I am secure, my heart is blessed. Amazing love, how can it be that thou, my God, should die for me? That thou, my God, should die. Thank you.
At the foot of the cross, where we experience the love of God. It's fixing our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter and finisher of our faith, where we experience the love of God. It's in the unthinkable sacrifice that Jesus made on our behalf that we experience fully the love of God. And Jesus said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, Jesus took a cup colored red with his disciples. To express to him, to them, and to us the extent of his love for us. And I ask Deacon Dave Hoogsteen to return thanks for the emblem that represents the purchase price of our salvation.
Lord our Father, we thank you so much for the gift of this table. As we consider the great sacrifice that was made on our behalf, your Son's innocent blood that was brutally shed for us so that we can be called children of God. From the beginning of creation, you had a plan to redeem us and give us new life through your Son. I'm asking that you would create in us a heart of repentance. Lord, forgive us our sins. God, no matter the circumstances we find ourselves in, please let us not waste the joy of our salvation. Lord, please give us the strength to love and serve one another so that we can show this lost world what it looks like to be reborn and made anew in Christ Jesus. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Came
soared, and the church of Christ was born, and His Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth of old shall not kneel and shall not faint. By His blood and in His name, in His freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me.
Jesus took the cup with His disciples, and He drank all of it, the cup of God's wrath for you and for me, because He loves us. Jesus said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until He comes. Among the parting words of Jesus before He ascended into heaven, before He went to the cross of Calvary and ascended into heaven, He said to His disciples, "In this world you will have trouble. And I've told you this in advance so that you won't be surprised. It doesn't mean that I have left you. It doesn't mean that my love has been withdrawn from you. I have overcome the world. And you are more than conquerors through Christ." So, beloved, we are loved by the Heavenly Father through Jesus Christ our Lord, who gave His life for us in order that we might be able to love one another and thereby strengthen our brothers and sisters in their troubles and hurts and pain, that they might experience the love of God and that God's love might be made perfect in us, completed, accomplish its intended purpose. I urge you and encourage you to keep your eyes fixed not on the waves of trouble that come your way, but on the Lord Jesus Christ who gave Himself for you. Our Father, thank you for this incredible truth that you have lifted us out of the wilderness of feeling unloved. And in some cases, Lord, there are people here who are experiencing not being loved by friends or family. But the truth of the matter is that anyone who is in Christ Jesus is loved by God, and nothing can separate them from your love for them. And may that love sustain and carry them, because it's perfect love, providential love, and permanent love. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.